Mentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Genentech, The Beginnings of Biotech by Sally Smith Hughes, narrated by Suzie Althens. Publisher's Note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to visual elements present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Prologue. Genentech, The Beginnings of Biotech, is the story of a pioneering genetic engineering company that inspired a new industrial sector, transforming the biomedical and commercial landscapes ever after. Yet the enormous success of Genentech, today an icon of a worldwide biotechnology industry, appears to confirm an industrial myth that the company's achievements and the industry it fostered were straightforward, preordained, and inevitable events. This interpretation is far from the mark. Genentech was, by almost any measure, an inauspicious and improbable enterprise. The firm arose in the spring of 1976 as the unlikely vision of two naive entrepreneurs, Herbert Boyer, a professor of microbiology at the University of California, San Francisco, and Robert Swanson, an unemployed venture capitalist. Its name, a contraction of genetic engineering technology, captured its extraordinary agenda: to apply the radically new technology of recombinant DNA in engineering bacteria to make insulin, growth hormone, and other important pharmaceuticals. But no one had ever employed the technology as an industrial process, much less built a business upon it and tried to make a profit from it. Could the company produce, before the money ran out, the novel therapeutic substances Boyer and Swanson had in mind? Prominent molecular biologists thought not. The making of Genentech was, in fact, racked by problems, internal and external. The science did not always work. Swanson and Boyer struggled to raise and sustain venture capital backing and to forge contracts with a skeptical pharmaceutical industry. Scientists, managers, and attorneys needed cajoling and incentives to abandon university and corporate positions to join a company broadcasting risk at every level. In a tumultuous period of science politics, pending government regulation and adverse public opinion threatened substantial interference. Swanson and Boyer had to devise corporate structure and erect intellectual property protection, giving Genentech a chance to compete against far larger and well-established companies with vastly deeper pockets. He needed to somehow balance a freewheeling, university-like culture against the dire need to eke out a profit, file for patents, and above all, make marketable products. The cards appeared stacked against the venture's success. External conditions, likewise, menaced Genentech's agenda to put genes to work. The firm struggled to get off the ground during a time of soaring public apprehension over biology's new power to engineer bacteria of possible threat to human health and safety. As if the deepening scientific, political, and cultural ferment were not enough, the infant company had to also navigate federal guidelines for recombinant DNA research, face the threat of restrictive legislation, and run the gauntlet of legal unknowns in patenting living things. Genentech's future rested on technological innovation, business acumen, human dedication, and a freewheeling, can-do culture strikingly different from anything the pharmaceutical industry offered. Its handful of irreverent scientists captured a swiftly expanding audience as they cloned and expressed three medically significant genes in three successive years: human insulin, human growth hormone, and human interferon. The latter, a supposed miracle drug, predicted to cure cancer and other ills. Genentech's come-from-behind scientific contests against prestigious university teams led to biotechnology's first research and development contracts with pharmaceutical companies. By 1980, the firm was setting scientific and business standards that a handful of fledgling biotech companies and academic entrepreneurs would attempt to emulate and adapt to their specific needs. Molecular biology was becoming practical, profitable, and controversial in a manner never before experienced. Remarkably, just 4 years after its creation, Genentech became the overnight darling of Wall Street. Its public stock offering raised over $38 million, as share price rocketed from $35 to $89 in a wild first few minutes of trading. It was the largest gain in stock market history, making headlines around the world. To the investment and business communities and a riveted public, agog at what they were witnessing, the company confirmed that genetic engineering could build a business, attract major money, and promise life-saving pharmaceuticals as well. Genentech's spectacular success launched a period of speculative frenzy over biotechnology as a revolutionary approach for creating novel products, generating incalculable profits, and fashioning a new industrial sector. This intimate and people-centered history traces the seminal early years of a company that devised new models for biomedical research, business, and culture, in the process introducing a novel creation, the entrepreneurial biologist. As a prime instigator of a mounting commercialism blossoming in biology of the 1970s, Genentech, in large measure, recast the aspirations, direction, and culture of life science and set the stage for the formation of a biotechnology industry. 1. Inventing recombinant DNA technology. I looked at the first gels in the first recombinant DNA cloning experiment, and I can remember tears coming into my eyes. It was so nice. I mean, there it was. You could visualize your results in physical terms, and after that, we knew we could do a lot of things. Herbert W. Boyer, March 28, 1994. Modern biotechnology originated in 1973 with the invention of recombinant DNA technology, a now universal form of genetic engineering. It entails recombining, joining, pieces of DNA in a test tube, cloning, creating identical copies of DNA in a bacterium or other organism, and expressing the DNA code as a protein or RNA molecule. It soon vastly extended the power and scope of molecular biology, penetrated several industrial sectors, and became a cornerstone of a new industry of biotechnology. Yet, technological power and potential cannot alone explain its first commercial application. At the biotechnology company Genentech in the mid-1970s, Stanley Cohen and Herbert Boyer, the two inventors, had designed the technique for basic science research. But they immediately foresaw its practical applications in making plentiful quantities of insulin, growth hormone, and other useful substances in bacteria. Despite their common starting point, Cohen and Boyer chose different avenues for industrializing recombinant DNA technology. Why they did so was a matter of personality and professional commitments. It was also a matter of the national environment in the U.S. of the 1970s, a pivotal decade of raging debate in science politics, major dilemmas and decisions in constitutional and patent law, and cultural, attitudinal, and personal challenges as commercial interests first entered molecular biology full force. Two scientists on converging paths. Herbert Wayne Boyer was born in 1936 into a blue-collar family and grew up in the little town of Derry, 30 miles from Pittsburgh in the coal mining country of western Pennsylvania. His father had left school in eighth grade and eventually found work as a railroad brakeman and conductor. His mother married straight out of high school and stayed home to look after Herb and a younger sister. Herb earned pocket money by mowing lawns, delivering newspapers, and doing other odd jobs of a middle American boyhood. He hunted and fished with his father and developed an abiding love of the outdoors. All four Boyers played at least one musical instrument and regularly got together with family and friends to play country western music. Bright spots in an otherwise workaday world. Herb's first years at Derryboro High School were a steady round of football, basketball, baseball, and girls, anything but academic achievement. He was on a rather perilous course of delinquency, he later admitted. It took a no-nonsense football coach and teacher to jolt Herb out of his apathy. Pat Bucci straightened me out, he subsequently observed, he began, belatedly, to focus on schoolwork. Coming into his own, he was elected junior and senior class president and voted most athletic. But the limited vistas of a small railroad town felt more and more confining. One way or another, he had to get out. Herb resolved to go on to college, the first in his family to do so. He was off to troll wider horizons, but destined never to lose the down-to-earth practicality and lack of pretension of his blue-collar upbringing. Stanley Norman Cohen is also the first child and only son of parents whose formal education ended with high school. His father was a small businessman who tried his hand, never very successfully, at several trades in and around their home in Perth Amboy, New Jersey, a town just southwest of New York City. Stan's mother worked for a time as a secretary to make ends meet. Stan was born in 1935 and raised as an only child until the birth of a sister when Stan was almost 10. Tight finances, gentle discipline, and parental ambition for their children to rise in the world largely defined home life. While Boyer needed Coach Bucci's intervention to provoke his attention to schoolwork, learning came naturally and at an early age for Cohen. No adult had to build discipline in young Stan. I suppose, he recalled, that overall I wasn't much of a wayward kid, so there really wasn't a lot of need for discipline. He and his father, a frustrated inventor, spent off hours in the basement doing small wiring and mechanical projects. Cohen credits his father with sparking his interest in how things work, sparking his interest in science. From the start, he was motivated to achieve, and achieve he consistently did. In high school, he was editor of the school paper and associate editor of the yearbook. By then, his scientific interests centered on biology, which to Stan meant becoming a physician. He now had a goal that would move him beyond the narrow scope of his upbringing. Yet he would remain stamped with the work ethic, professional ambition, and respect for knowledge of his Jewish heritage. Boyer and Cohen, with only slightly more than a year between them, came of age in the early 1950s. Both were financially strapped. Both could expect no financial assistance from their families. Both chose colleges close to home. In 1954, Boyer entered St. Vincent College, a liberal arts institution run by Benedictine monks in Latrobe, Pennsylvania, a few easy miles from Derry. He lived at home to save money and hitchhiked or rode the bus to and from classes. His father, a railroad man, refused to learn to drive, let alone to buy a family car. Boyer majored in biology and chemistry, intending to go on to medical school. A chance class assignment suggested another direction. More than five decades later, Boyer recalled the shift with the clarity of a formative moment. "We had a brand new, shiny cell physiology textbook with a blue and white cover. Each of us was assigned a chapter, and we had to give a seminar on it. Which one did I get? The structure of DNA. This was 1957, and the buzz of DNA was just getting into the textbooks. I was really taken with the Watson-Crick structure of DNA, and this started my fascination with the heuristic value of the structure." A sign of his new infatuation was Boyer's Siamese cats, Watson and Crick. In 1958, St. Vincent awarded Boyer a bachelor's degree in biology and chemistry. Boyer applied and failed to enter medical school, a D in metaphysics being his nemesis. He settled on graduate school at the University of Pittsburgh, partly to improve his grades and reapply to medical school, partly because a small-town boy doesn't stray too far from home. He craved intellectual stimulus and found it in the heady research of a bacterial genetics laboratory at a watershed moment in molecular biology. Watson and Crick's discovery of 1953 had launched an avalanche of work on major questions, prime among them, the nature of the genetic code and the mechanism of protein synthesis. Much of this research transpired in bacteria, employed by experimentalists for their relative simplicity as compared to the animal kingdom. Boyer thrived on the lab's scientific ferment and freeform discussion on genetic exchange and recombination in bacteria, That lab, Boyer recalled, was my scientific awakening. In 1959, at the end of his first year of graduate school, Boyer married his high school sweetheart, Mary Grace Hensler, a biologist in her own right. She gamely supported the couple as Boyer tackled a near intractable experiment on deciphering the genetic code. Breaking the code was the foremost problem in molecular biology of the day, one that only a supremely ambitious, or naive, graduate student would agree to take on. Boyer did and plugged away, even after two biochemists broke the code in 1961. Boyer, a future colleague commented, consistently tried big things without knowing whether they could or should work. He managed to squeeze out enough data to complete a dissertation. His attraction to challenging problems would become a mark of his professional career. Boyer was setting an enduring pattern. Below the casual surface lay ambition and tenacity. In 1963, Boyer earned a doctoral degree in bacteriology. Cohen chose Rutgers University, a few short miles from Perth Amboy. Rutgers offered the most scholarship support and was close to his ailing father. Studious as ever, Cohen worked hard but carried to extremes his resolve to make a life beyond academics. He joined the university debating team, took up the guitar, and tried his hand at writing pop songs, one of which reached the hit parade. This flurry of extracurricular activities, predictive in its intensity, failed to dent his academic performance. In 1956, he graduated magna cum laude from Rutgers. That fall, Cohen entered medical school at the University of Pennsylvania, a major draw being the substantial scholarship funds it provided. His first taste of basic research in the second year led to a summer research position in London and to the publication of his first paper. He took time off that summer to wander the cafes of Europe, supporting himself by singing and strumming the banjo. It was a wonderful time, he recalled, remembering the freedom and lack of responsibility. Life from then on would never again be as carefree, but the banjo and song would remain outlets for life. In 1960, Cohen graduated from Penn with a degree in medicine. Within a whirlwind five-year period, swinging from the East Coast to the South, Cohen completed an internship, a two-year research position at the National Institutes of Health, NIH, and a residency in medicine. In 1961, he married Joanna Volter, and they eventually had two children. Boyer's career took a less peripatetic course. He went straight from Pittsburgh to Yale as a postdoctoral fellow in microbiology. There, he joined a lab focused on genetic exchange and recombination in bacteria. He became fascinated with the restriction enzymes of bacteria, enzymes that cut up and destroy foreign DNA entering the bacterial cell. The word just emerging in the 1960s was that certain types of restriction enzymes sever DNA at unique sequences in the molecule. Perhaps Boyer and others recognized one could use these strange enzymes to clip DNA into well-defined fragments and map its structure. He suspected early on that restriction enzymes were going to be very helpful enzymes for the precision cutting, recombination, and characterization of DNA. The suspicion was prophetic. His career-long passion would become restriction enzyme research and genetic manipulation. Boyer now lived and breathed his science. After a night on the town, he would return to the lab or rise in the dark to observe an experiment. But the folks at home were stymied. "What are you doing?" his father would ask. "Restriction endonuclease modification," he would glibly answer, using the technical term for his research area. He would then pause for his father's inevitable retort. "Well, what good is it? What are you going to do with that?" Boyer would respond, "I don't know, cure the common cold." His answer was dismissive, but his father's question prompted him to ponder the practical utility of his research. Cohen, meanwhile, had begun a postdoctoral research fellowship in molecular biology at Albert Einstein College of Medicine in New York. It was here he stopped wavering between a career in medicine or science. He decided to pursue both, apparently expecting the rewards of a dual career to outbalance its tensions and frantic pace. he took up research on plasmids, tiny rings of DNA in the cytoplasm of bacterial cells that reproduce outside the main chromosome. Plasmids typically carry antibiotic-resistant genes that can pass from one bacterium to another, spreading the resistance problem. The study of plasmids was, at the time, a quiet backwater, and to Cohen, consequently appealing. Scientists interested in genetic exchange and gene regulation mainly studied viruses, which had been a central focus of molecular studies from the 1930s on. Cohen reasoned that his heavy clinical responsibilities would make successful competition with hotshot molecular biology labs difficult, if not impossible. Plasmid research seemed a perfect fit. He knew the necessary molecular and biochemical techniques, and the growing medical problem of antibiotic resistance was an appropriate topic for a physician. He was correct in every regard, except for expecting the field to remain tranquil. It was about to explode, and Cohen would find himself at its epicenter. By 1968, Cohen was intent on finding a faculty position. One of his mentors had collegial associations with several members of the biochemistry department at Stanford University. The connections led to a job offer, but not in biochemistry. Some years earlier, the clinical departments at Stanford Hospital in San Francisco had moved south to join the preclinical departments on Stanford's Palo Alto campus, a reorganization aimed at bringing basic science and clinical medicine into geographic and intellectual proximity. Recognizing Cohen as one of the new breed of physician scientists the school sought to attract, the Department of Medicine offered Cohen an assistant professorship in its division of hematology. Cohen, drawn by the California climate and lifestyle, accepted, and in 1968 moved with his wife to the sun-swept campus in Palo Alto. He was disheartened to find that no one in the department shared his fascination with molecular genetics. He turned for advice to Arthur Kornberg, the powerful chairman of Stanford's biochemistry department. By virtue of his Nobel Prize, academic position, and forceful personality, Kornberg was a figure to reckon with. Not one to mince words, he told Cohen that plasmid research was an uninteresting line of investigation. The irony of the remark would soon become apparent. "So this wasn't a very comforting introduction to Stanford," Cohen recalled. His understatement skated over what must have been an unsettling blow. He had come to Stanford considering that shared scientific interests and collegial ties might lead to a joint appointment in the Department of Biochemistry. Instead, Kornberg made it clear that Cohen's association with the department was at best to be informal. Kornberg almost never granted joint appointments and also believed that only a rare individual could optimally perform both clinical medicine and basic research. Despite the tepid welcome, and even after his own lab was operating, Cohen, according to biochemist Paul Berg, hung around in the Department of Biochemistry most of the time. Berg exaggerated, but Cohen, indeed, thrived on the department's stimulating intellectual exchange and had access to its electron microscope and other equipment lacking in his home department. He regularly attended biochemistry seminars and benefited from the chance to bounce ideas off people in that department. He particularly profited from discussing ongoing departmental research on DNA ligation, joining, and DNA uptake by animal cells. In turn, he shared with biochemistry colleagues his work on plasmid isolation and characterization. But the research Cohen published in the early 1970s was not done in collaboration with Stanford biochemistry faculty. As he stated forcefully in 2010, notwithstanding Kornberg's notion that all important scientific knowledge at Stanford originated in the Department of Biochemistry, the work on DNA replication in that department had absolutely zero impact on my research. Similarly, the work on biochemical methods of DAT joining, a biochemical method for joining DNA fragments, by Berg and others did not impact my work. Cohen was using plasmids to transport genes and DNA fragments into bacteria. Berg's group and others in Stanford biochemistry were using viruses as transport vehicles. The department was at the forefront of techniques for joining DNA molecules from different sources. In 1972, Berg and his lab succeeded in making the first recombinant DNA molecules in a test tube. However, no member of the Stanford biochemistry faculty, or anyone elsewhere, created a method for cloning DNA. The various biochemical approaches Berg and the others developed for recombining DNA were technically complicated and required a battery of enzymes and skills, probably beyond the ability of most labs, as Berg himself admitted. The dire need for a simple and efficient method for joining and replicating genetic material continued to go unanswered. Boyer was also looking for a faculty appointment as his postdoctoral years wound down. Hearing of an open position in the microbiology department at the University of California, San Francisco, he applied, lured less by the medical school's reputation, mediocre, than by the charms of the Golden State. He loved cowboy and Indian movies and had always wanted to visit California. Boyer accepted an appointment as assistant professor at an annual salary of $12,500 and in 1966 moved with his family to join the basic science faculty. Denied the promised lab space in one of the new research towers, he settled, much annoyed, into cramped laboratories in a department chaired by an old-school microbiologist with no interest in molecular genetics. Boyer found diversion in the rich protest and countercultural movements of the Bay Area in the 1960s, later telling a reporter that he had participated in nearly every anti-war rally in the vicinity. Like many of his colleagues, he was captivated by the growing technical power of the new genetics to manipulate the stuff of life. But he was also troubled by its social and ethical implications. How far should scientists go in their ability to tamper with life? In one of many occasions, he and others at a molecular biology meeting spent an entire evening discussing how genetic engineering might affect society for good and ill. It was not the last time Boyer would participate in gatherings on social accountability in science, although as the tables turned, he would find himself protesting governmental efforts to restrain science. His social activism served as a diversion at a time when his research, despite long, laborious hours, was only marginally productive. He spent 4 years studying a restriction enzyme that he eventually concluded cut the DNA molecule in an unhelpfully random fashion. What drove him was to find one that made a unique and predictable break. Discouraged by his lack of research progress and feeling like a fish out of water in his department, he thought of searching for a position elsewhere. Then circumstances began to improve. UCSF administrators, determined for more than a decade to turn a second-tier medical school into a premier research institution, had by the late 1960s decided that the Department of Biochemistry should lead the way. An individual, widely credited with facilitating the revitalization, arrived in 1968 in the driving and dapper person of William J. Rutter. The tirelessly resolute biochemist, a strategic thinker if there ever was one, appeared under the ambitious banner of building a biochemistry department that would apply breaking knowledge in molecular biology and biochemistry to research on the complex genetic mechanisms of higher organisms. It was a deliberate departure, in which he was not alone, from molecular biology's traditional focus on bacteria and viruses and an agenda requiring the latest techniques to decipher the complicated genomes of higher organisms. Rutter's multidisciplinary research strategy and the cooperative interdepartmental culture he sought to foster were highly compatible with Boyer's research interests and collaborative scientific style. After the arrival of biochemist Howard Goodman in 1970, one of Rutter's early recruits, Boyer spent ever more time in the biochemistry department, working closely with Goodman on restriction enzyme problems. It became a second academic home for seminars, chit-chat, and the collegiality and conviviality he thrived on. The biochemistry department, Boyer recalled, got to be a very exciting place in the early 70s for me. Like Cohen, he had found an environment far more compatible with his research interests than his own department. Cohen, meanwhile, juggled a staggering workload in three different areas. He had demanding clinical and basic research obligations and was also collaborating and publishing on a computer-based system for identifying drug interactions. Yet somehow, his productivity only increased. In 1970-72, he published 13 papers, including 9 on plasmids. By mid-1972, he and two assistants had developed a system for removing plasmid DNA from bacterial cells, shearing it into pieces in a blender, and inserting single molecules of plasmid DNA into bacteria to study plasmid structure and antibiotic resistance. But the procedure was slow and inefficient. The shearing process broke the plasmid DNA into a welter of random-length fragments, making selection and study difficult. And only on rare occasion did the plasmid DNA enter the bacterial cells. Cohen pondered these deficiencies of his plasmid transfer system as he began to organize a conference on plasmid research scheduled for November 1972 in Honolulu. Unknown to Cohen at the time, the Boyer lab that year had made a related discovery. A graduate student had isolated a restriction enzyme, the soon-to-be widely employed ECOR1, that cut DNA predictably at a specific position in the molecule, exactly the characteristics that Boyer had long sought. Especially exciting was the finding, by scientists in Stanford Biochemistry and Genetics, to whom Boyer had donated the enzyme in generous quantity, that ECOR1 did not cut evenly through the double strands of the DNA molecule. Instead, it made a staggered cut, creating two single projecting DNA strands. Each single strand was able to bond with a complementary DNA strand, as one Velcro strip unites with another. The Goodman and Boyer labs confirmed the Stanford finding by sequencing the DNA site cut by ECOR1 and determining the order of the nucleotide subunits composing the restriction site. The idea of using cohesive, or sticky ends, as they were called, to join DNA fragments had been around for a decade or so. In fact, several groups in Stanford biochemistry were chemically synthesizing artificial sticky ends, attaching them to DNA fragments, and using the sticky ends to splice one fragment to another. The procedures were long and tedious. Boyer's enzyme, with its natural ability to create sticky ends in just one step, offered a substantial leap in ease and efficiency in splicing together DNA pieces to form recombinant molecules. Trying to capitalize on these features, Boyer and Robert Helling, a biochemist on sabbatical leave in Boyer's lab, were using the ECOR1 enzyme in attempts to combine DNA fragments. It was the summer of 1972, and they were getting nowhere. The collaboration. Cohen, meanwhile, was organizing the Honolulu Plasmid Conference, and belatedly got word of Boyer's as yet unpublished work on the new restriction enzyme. Seeing its possible relevance to characterizing plasmid DNA, he issued Boyer, whom he had never met, a last-minute invitation to attend the conference. Boyer recognized a golden chance to talk about ECOR1 and agreed to come. In November, Cohen and Boyer arrived in Honolulu for the conference, neither knowing the details of the other's research. As it came time for Boyer to present, Cohen listened raptly to his description of ECOR1's properties. His mind lit up when he heard that the enzyme cut DNA molecules predictably and reproducibly into unique fragments with sticky ends. In a flash of insight, he wondered, could one use Boyer's enzyme to sever a plasmid precisely and use the sticky ends to attach a second DNA fragment? The hybrid plasmid might then be inserted into bacteria for cloning. The startling concept, if found to work, might solve the randomness and inefficiency of his plasmid transfer procedure. He urgently needed to talk with Boyer. The occasion arose after a long day of presentations in a stuffy conference hall. Cohen and Boyer decided to take a stroll with some colleagues, eager to stretch their legs and take in the balmy air of a Hawaiian evening. The walk gave Cohen and Boyer a chance to talk about the ongoing experiments in their labs. In a flash, it struck them that they might have between them the makings of a method for joining and cloning DNA molecules. Pausing at a delicatessen near the beach at Waikiki, the group settled into a booth and ordered sandwiches and beer. Cohen and Boyer grew increasingly jazzed, as Boyer later put it, about the potential synergism of their separate approaches for isolating and copying selected DNA fragments. But would the ideas brainstormed over beer and deli sandwiches pan out in actual experiment? Cohen proposed a collaboration to find out. Boyer's first impulse was to donate some of his enzyme, as he had done for the Stanford scientists, and let Cohen conduct the experiment on his own. Cohen recalled saying, "Well, that doesn't seem quite fair. Your lab has spent a lot of time isolating the enzyme, and we should do this as a collaboration." Also to the point, Cohen needed the Boyer lab's expertise in restriction enzymes for the experiment to transpire as conceived. Boyer agreed to collaborate. Shared interests and the need for combined expertise and resources brought together two very different personalities. In many ways, they were polar opposites in manner, demeanor, and approach to life. Boyer came across as gregarious, relaxed, and unassuming. Open to new ideas, he was willing to gamble on possibilities. Cohen struck others as private, circumspect, and exacting of himself and colleagues. Both men were inveterate workaholics and passionate about their science, but their passion manifested in contrasting manners. Boyer ran an expansively chaotic lab and preferred brainstorming over a beer. Cohen headed a small, self-contained lab group and often discussed research in the quiet of his office. Even in appearance, the contrast was striking. Boyer sported a mop of unruly brown hair, an open and cherubic face, a robust figure, and attire of jeans, running shoes, and leather vest that stretched the limits of casual. A reporter later described him as a Baroque angel in blue jeans. Cohen was trim, bearded, balding, and bespectacled. He dressed casually but neatly in slacks and sweater or sport jacket. He was the quintessential image of the professor, solid citizen, and serious intellectual. In January 1973, Cohen and Boyer began the experiment outlined in Honolulu, working it into their ongoing projects and initially giving it no exceptional priority. The specific knowledge and technical expertise of each lab defined a natural division of labor. The Cohen laboratory handled the plasmid isolation and transfer work, Boyer's the enzymology and electrophoresis studies. In a stroke of fortune, Boyer had visited colleagues on his return from Honolulu who had demonstrated their method for staining DNA fragments with a fluorescent dye that made the fragments stand out vividly on electrophoresis gels. He brought the technique back to Bob Helling, still pursuing sabbatical research in Boyer's lab, who did further work correlating fragment size and mobility on the gels. But the ultimate outcome of the experiment was anything but clear. As Cohen later observed, "There are some people who think that once a method of biochemical joining DNA ends was worked out, it was obvious that the chimeric, recombinant DNA could be cloned. That's easy to say in retrospect, but in actuality, it was not the case, especially for DNA molecules that contain components derived from different biological species." Uncertain of the experiment's success, Cohen assigned it to his research assistant, Annie Chang, rather than to one of his postdoctoral students, whose career might suffer if the project failed. Chang, who lived in San Francisco, became the conduit between the two labs, ferrying plasmid samples back and forth in her Volkswagen Beetle. In remarkably short order, they had results. On a triumphal day in March, Boyer and Helling examined the electrophoresis gels displaying the various DNA fragments. There, in plain sight, was a telltale band composed of two types of plasmid DNA standing out in fluorescent orange. To their inestimable joy, they had not only recombined DNA, they had cloned it. The engineered plasmids, with their ability to reproduce themselves in the bacterial cells, had also faithfully cloned the foreign DNA inserted into them. The sight brought tears to Boyer's eyes. Here before him was evidence of a simple method for isolating and accurately copying specific genes and DNA fragments in virtually endless quantity. He recalled the emotional moment. The DNA bands were lined up on the gel, and you could just look at them, and you knew that DNA recombination and cloning had been successful. I was just ecstatic. I remember going home and showing a photograph of the gel to my wife. You know, I looked at that thing until early in the morning. When I saw it, I knew that you could do just about anything. I was really moved by it. I had tears welling up in my eyes because it was sort of a cloudy vision of what was to come. For Cohen, that moment was elation. The experiment had worked like a charm. He and Boyer had invented a technique that outshone in simplicity and efficiency anything the Stanford biochemist or anyone else had devised for joining DNA fragments. But the crowning accomplishment was the invention of a straightforward technique for cloning DNA, a technique so simple that high school students would soon use it. Boyer later remarked on how neatly new knowledge and breaking techniques had converged. Things just came together at that time. The study of small plasmids, transformation of E. coli with plasmid DNA, the restriction enzyme business, it was all coming to fruition at the same time. The experiment went very fast. It was straightforward. There was not much in the way of struggle. The first experiments more or less worked. The novel idea for the cloning procedure was strictly their own. But as both Cohen and Boyer acknowledged, they had benefited enormously from the intellectual milieu and technical breakthroughs in molecular biology and biochemistry for manipulating and characterizing DNA molecules. Scientific and technological convergence set the stage for their dazzling invention. The paper published in November 1973, 1 year to the month after the seminal meeting in Hawaii, was a strictly scientific account relayed in the sober language of science. But they allowed themselves one speculation. Although the experiment involved only plasmid DNA, Cohen and Boyer suggested something more sweeping. Their method, they ventured, was not restricted to lowly plasmids. They foresaw it becoming a general tool for selecting and cloning the DNA of organisms up and down the evolutionary scale. What had started as an experiment to further their respective interests in plasmids and restriction enzymes suddenly appeared to possess far wider applications. Cohen, a cautious foil to the outgoing Boyer, pressed to keep the research quiet until it was published and their priority established. It was not an unreasonable request, particularly considering the fearsomely competitive Stanford biochemists working a few floors away. But in June 1973, before publication of their experiment, Boyer attended a meeting on nucleic acids, one of the annual Gordon.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.